it started. I think other people are on the way. Comments or questions before we begin? So our schedule this afternoon will start at 2, and we have 3 presentations, and we think we've solved the technical issues. So I'll come back here at 2 today. So one last call for any comments or questions before we start. Today is I decided to take us into the sutra literature and to look at some of the things that are said about the various bodies, and also what it means for relics. Particularly in the Vayan Sutra, it says that our bodies are originally the Dharma Dhatu. And that's a very major statement in terms of what is the nature of our body from the point of view of the Buddhist. And we've talked about the Dharma Dhatu before, and I'll have to, I think, maybe review us a little bit, and we can discuss this in more detail. We know from the Heart Sutra that it says there is a lack of body. There's a lack of an eye, ear, nose, tongue, body, and mind. It says there is a lack of all of these things, including a lack of feelings, cognition, impulses, consciousness. There's a lack of all of these according to that particular sutra. The Dharma Dhatu, when it says that our body is the Dharma Dhatu is defined as the essence or the expanse of phenomena. The Dharma Dhatu is everything. Basically, that's what it says. The Dharma Dhatu is the endlessness of space, the endlessness of time. It's just the expanse of everything that's in itself endless. So from that perspective, what the text is saying is our body is no different than everything else. There's no real distinction between our body and the whole of everything. What we're made up of is what everything is made up of. So they make no distinction that somehow our body is a real and distinct different thing in the cosmos. They just say we're part and parcel of it. We're just an aspect of it, that's all. So you have to take this and think of it in the sense of, if the whole of the Dharma Dhatu is filled with photons, and photons go, we don't know how far, they're just everywhere. And if we broke our body down to its most basic component, we would just be photons. Atoms, molecules, all of them eventually break down to photons at this point. We know that if you smash photons together, like the collider in Switzerland, there is debris. And that debris says that a photon is not the smallest thing in the whole of the Dharmadhatu. There is something smaller. That is the debris of a photon. And we suspect, although I think it will never, I don't know that it, certainly in my lifetime we'll ever have enough energy to prove it, that even the debris of a photon breaks down. So when we talk about, in the Buddhist sense, what is the nature of our bodies, we have to say from one point of view, we are just part of everything. So let's go back just a little bit. The texts recognize that there are feelings, there are cognitions, there's consciousness, we have eyes and ears, nose. So we live in the world where these things are functioning. And we wake up this morning and we opened our eyes and everybody in the room is sighted, so we all opened our eyes and saw the world. We woke up this morning and we were back in our bodies. Our bodies made up of the organs. So this is that double-edged analysis of Buddhism. To say you can have functioning things, you can have the impulses, you can have consciousness. However, if you really analyze it, if you keep on looking at it and breaking it down into smaller bits, then it turns out that there is nothing in an ear in terms of its photons and atoms which makes the ear distinctly different from the nose. The functioning that we see is a momentary, temporary, systemic functionality. So the Buddhists are always saying that we cannot be confused by something which is functional to think that it has an inherent self and essential nature, that it's its own thing. And this you've heard many times, and it's old hat, I know. So that's why we use the automobile. The automobile is nothing but the Dharmadhatu. There's nothing inherently different in an automobile that is different from my body from one perspective. And yet from another perspective, its functionality is very different than the functionality of my body. And we know that we can take a car and make it into all of its parts, and then we don't call it a car anymore. And then we put the parts back together, and at some point we say, it's a car. So when we've been talking about the body all these long weeks and long hours that you've been so patiently sitting here, from one perspective, what the text is saying, there is a lack of a body. What are we talking about? The body that we talk about, from one perspective, we talked about the body as emptiness, but it's more than emptiness. It's like saying, from one perspective, there is absolutely no distinction in the photonic level between our body and a chair, between our ear and an eye, between the eye and the fingertip. So the Buddha said recognize this, and that's why in the Huayan Jing it says our body is simply the Dharmadhatu. If it's the Dharmadhatu, and if everything is Dharmadhatu, then the text is quite right in saying form cannot be measured. In endlessness, you cannot measure anything. There is no way to measure unless you can find some kind of beginning and end. Or even if you designate two points within the flow, that is hardly measurement of the total thing. So I can measure the distance between my two eyes. Is that the measurement of me? If somebody says, how tall are you? We say, I can tell you from the ground up to the top of my head is a certain measurement. We know that. We can measure that, but we have no idea how big or small that is in the Dharmadhatu. And the answer is, it's neither. There is no such thing as large and small in endlessness. So therefore, all mental states are measureless. Form itself is measureless. Time is measureless. Because they're all part of the Dharmadhatu. So our bodies cannot be measured from one perspective in the Buddhist sense. We do it. We go to the doctor. We say, take my blood pressure. Weigh me. Count my heartbeats. We go to be measured. And yet, and of course, the measurements are not wrong. They are simply not a measurement of the totality of the body. So I'm saying that our bodies are measureless from a Buddhist perspective. And if they are not able to be measured, then in a sense, there are no bodies. All that we measure are relative dimensions. We just get two arbitrary points and we measure between them. But that's not measuring space, really. That's not measuring anything other than this is between those two points. Any comment or question about this? Yes, please.
Most provocative when you say the body is measureless. You said that, right?
Yes.
I know the consciousness part of our body is measureless. Is that why you said that? Because
it's measureless in this sense, as I understand what the Buddha say and what science is beginning to say. We are made up of photons. At one level, that's all we are. Those photons are simply part of an unmeasurable totality of everything. We are just in the midst of all these endless photons. So our photons that get clumped together, maybe in a particular way, but even they don't show it when you go down to the photonic level. You lose all sight of bones, you lose all sight of measurement, weight, health, size, color. None of that extends to that level. So from that perspective, when the Buddhists say, and as I, to those who have come in, ultimately, the Hwayin Sutra says our bodies are originally the Dharma Dhatu. That's a big statement. That is, our bodies are part of the essence or the expanse of phenomena. And as such, from one perspective, the body cannot be measured. It loses its ability to be measured when it is taken to that level. So it's like if we could have it in virtual reality, what I would do is you would have on the glasses here in the room, and you would have your body, and then I would say, and now we're going to go to the photonic level. So we start moving toward it, and we move to a molecular level, and suddenly we are all molecules. And then we keep moving, and we go to the atomic level, and suddenly we're all swirling atoms. And then we take it to the subatomic level, where we move toward a photonic level, and when we hit the photons, everything is the same. Everything. At that level. So therefore, if, as the Buddhists say, at the photonic level, I'm just using that as a scientific equivalent for the Dharma Dhatu. So at that level, if that's what our body is, that our body is just the Dharma Dhatu, then it's measureless. Is that?
Yes, but it's still very mind-blowing. I understand part of it, especially when I was doing my crash course on quantum physics.
Yes.
But I guess we as ordinary beings are so used to looking at body mass. So on a medical level, we always have this delusion on a daily basis we can measure our body mass.
Yes.
So, but we're looking beyond the more original nature, so, yeah.
Well, I guess the point I say is, I can lose 15 pounds. Right. So then my body mass changes.
What's the point?
The idea of what is measurable, I guess, comes into question, right? So if I lose weight, if one becomes pregnant, right, then has a child. So in that essence, I think that our bodies are measureless because it changes and shifts all the time. We may lose our hair, our teeth, you know. So my arm length is much different than when I was, you know, 10. So it'll probably be different when I will shrink as I age, you know, that people do. Right? I mean, so I guess there is a continuum of how our bodies will shift during a lifetime. So I guess for me it's easy to buy that our bodies are measureless.
That's why the Buddhists say that there are two levels of truth. There's one level that we live at in an ordinary life, where we have organs, we have eyes, we have nose, we have pain, we live at this level. But at the same time, like it or not, there is another level at which all of those things are quite different. They're quite different. And we're living both of them simultaneously.
I was going to say that the question of the boundaries of the individual, the boundaries of the me, not being solid, is that that's, you know, it's something that's so often spoken about with musicians, or most people who cultivate a sense of control of something which is not their body, whether it's a musician, people who practice fencing, or athletes. When you look at a skateboarder manipulating a skateboard in the middle of a jump, how can this person even control something so exquisitely just with their feet? Well, for that person, they've penetrated the plasticity of the boundary between themselves and their instrument. And before we were fully comfortable with our own bodies as beings, you know, the boundary of the body is the extent of it. There is a time in our lives when our boundary doesn't even extend to our own bodies. It takes many years for a baby to realize that they have control of their own body enough to walk, or realize that the objects twitching at the edges of its peripheral vision are its own hands, and that it can control them and make fists or walk or kick.
And the Buddhists, that's why they do the double truth. They say, of course, we live that up at that. We have that experience. We live at that level. With your 15 pounds coming and going, at the photonic level, it makes no difference. The photonic level is not increased by your loss of 15 pounds, or is it increased by your gain of 15 pounds? If photonic level, that's why the conservation of energy says nothing is ever lost. Nothing is ever really gained. You don't add to something which is endless. You can't add to it, and you can't take away from it either. And then the question is, what is the ethical behavior, and what are the ethical consequences of having such a concept? We can have the idea that nothing matters. After all, we're just photons. So after all, that person that I hurt or that person that I hit, they're just photons. There's no issue. And that's why the Buddhists will say that if you realize this, the strange thing is that what it causes in you is compassion. That if you get it right, that's what arises. So I have to have compassion for myself at one level. I really feel that this is my body. I really feel this is something I have to take care of. This is the only thing that matters to me, in the sense of day by day waking up and living with this body. And then when I realize I'm living with this body as if it's absolutely distinct from everything else. I see this line as dividing me from you, from the room, from everything. I have an edge. I have a surface. That's me on the inside of that edge and surface. And yet, as I said, if I could put us all into a virtual reality, which would be reality as it is, we would dissolve into photons. And I have to be compassionate to myself to say, then that says, who I am is not permanent. It's not a self. It doesn't have its own entity. And I'm sorry for myself, because that's the way I've always lived and loved, and to lose it is hard. To lose that sense is really hard, and I don't know how to act sometimes. It's demanding of me something which is really hard. It demands that I live at two levels at the same moment. And if I ignore one level, then I cut myself off from true reality. Because I do live at this level with the organs and with my experience. And what it makes me feel is that the more I think about these things like this, in one sense, the more I prize this life. It seems like it's a very special moment in the photons for me, or for this thing which I call me, it's a special time, a special event, if you will. So I shouldn't just throw it away, or ignore it, or say it's not worth anything, or after all, it's just part of the whole. It is part of the whole, but in a it's not measurable, but it's special at the same moment. That's just me trying to deal with the almost, you know, the fear of being dissolved. No, none of us wants to be dissolved. So if I show us as dissolved into photons, it could be quite confronting. In one sense, yes.
Maybe that's why I like to learn and study more about incarnation, because I feel like these special moments can be repeated if we take good care of it. And when I say it, I don't mean just me, I mean this it's this whole phenomenon. And being responsible and trying to be good. Then this special moment can't repeat itself as well. I'd like to believe.
If there's cause and effect, which the Buddhists also say, in other words, even within endlessness, cause and effect may be local, it's not everything, but locally it happens. The less I have to have an effect, the less I have to worry. You know, when I really want something, I get very tense and I really want it. I want a continuation or whatever. So this aspect of the body is, in the Buddhist texts, I think very demanding and really takes us to the edge of how we can think and challenges us, and it's ethically challenging. So the Ashta Sahasrika says, form is measureless. The perfection of wisdom in all mental states are measureless. So they try to explain it to people, and they use butter and milk. And they say, butter is inherent in milk. Butter is just the fat in milk. But it's all mixed up, and so you don't see butter when you buy a gallon of milk. Normally you don't see it unless it's risen to the top, but normal milk, you don't see it. So that's why they say we're like that, we don't see the Dharma Dhatu. Dharma Dhatu is in the same sense as the fat in the milk, it's just a part of the whole right now. So we don't see ourselves as photons. What I described to you, if I turned on and made a virtual reality experience of it, that's all it would be. It would be a creation. It would be a mimic. Because reality, we say it's virtual in one sense. It's like this, it just says, well, I see something and it looks like what's real, but reality, whatever reality I go to in one sense is virtual. It's being constructed by my thinking, like the little baby. The baby is slowly, mentally constructing an image of themselves. That image they're constructing is the one we live with for our whole life. we live with our body that we have constructed an idea about. And most of what we say about our body is our idea of it. So Dharmadhatu gets mixed together, says the text, with afflictions, with suffering. It gets mixed up and we don't see it anymore. So part of what the Buddhists then say to us is, it's like if you look at gold in a crystal and rock, it's all mixed in there. So how do you refine the Dharmadhatu, and can you, in such a way that you churn up the butter or you extract the thing which you want? How much can you do anything with Dharmadhatu? How much can you refine out of it so that you don't have suffering, so that you have enlightenment? Can you get enlightenment out of it? And how do you do that? And so that's one of the reasons why I think the Buddhists say, in one sense, you're going to have to put the Dharmadhatu aside. You put it aside on the basis that the reality is we have consciousness, we have this experience of this body, and so in order to deal with what we experience, we must produce a state of enlightenment with all our available functionality. The truth is we have a body. I feel it, I'm in it, I experience it, I add to it, I take away from it. So how do I refine the body to such a degree that I have a state called enlightenment? Do I do it with yoga? Do I do it with meditation? Do I do it with thinking? Do I do it with concentration? Do I do it with good works? How in the world do I refine my body in such a way that I can achieve something? So in one sense, that's why this ability to live at different levels at once is the challenge of Buddhism. And for a lot of people, it is not really comfortable and may not even be possible for some people to live at dual levels. In other words, can I perform at dual levels? A good actor has to do this. A good actor has to be able to walk out onto the stage. They can never forget, a good actor must never forget that they are acting. They never say, I lose myself in the character, because if you lose yourself in the character, then you can't act. But a good actor stands there and has a double role to play. Number one, they are who they are. They're the person that got up in the morning and went down to the theater and is now standing on the stage. From another perspective, though, they have to make real a character. They have to make that character so real that nobody can tell the difference between them and that character. And so when you watch a movie, you can become so involved with a good actor doing it that you think she's really who she's saying she is on the screen. And it's very hard for actors because people assume they are the part they play. So when they're greeted by people out in the streets, people say, I know you. I've seen all your movies. We should be good friends because I know who you are. And it's like, no, you don't. You have no idea who I am because that was a part I played. Somebody told me what to say. Somebody told me where to stand. The director told me when to smile and when to frown. And they know that. That's like when somebody said to Cary Grant, boy, I wish I was Cary Grant. And he replied, so do I. He would like to be that character. But that's not who he was. He was himself. And so that's why I think that actors are very susceptible to drugs. They're very susceptible to drugs because they want to feel. They have to, they're torn between these two realities of who they are on that stage and who they are when they get up in the morning. And they're not the same. So how do you have some of that experience over here? Well, you take a little cocaine up your nose and suddenly you feel really wonderful. Well, that's the way my character feels, is wonderful. So now I'm really in the character because I feel fantastic for a few hours. And then addiction sets in. But we're all like this to some degree. We all play double roles. We are the facade, the face we put forward to everybody, and yet there are always little voices in the back of our heads that are saying something quite different. We have our own internal conversations, which we don't always want to share with the rest of the world, because if they saw our internal conversations, they might be shocked, or they might be disturbed, or might be hurt, or whatever. So that in this Buddhist idea that the body is the Dharma Dhatu, we're playing two roles at once. One role is we have to live with our functional body. At the same time, there is this other role which is at the photonic level. And like it or not, that's being also lived at this very same moment. We're all doing it. We're living in it. And we don't know how to put them together. They just don't quite meet. So our intellectualizing about it or whatever. And that's why part of the meditative state is, in a sense, trying to make those two things meet. And when the sutra says, there's no body, there's no real thing, you have to realize these are constructed issues. The construct can be deconstructed. It's like a dream. It's real, but it's a dream. So what happens to us is, according to the Kuan, this moment is simply what happens when the prior moment has ceased. What I think right now, which is already past, is totally determined by the cessation of the prior moment of consciousness. In other words, we can't have a single consciousness that just is unbroken. it's the ultimate breakup of it. It is, you can't have a moment of consciousness unless the previous moment ceases. It's a little bit like royalty. You can't have a new king until the previous king dies. So, shout, the king is dead, long live the king, is exactly the way we live. My previous moment of consciousness is dead, long live the new moment of consciousness, which is now dead, and I've got a new one. This ceasing is, in fact, according to the Huayan Sutra, the condition we live in. We live in moments of consciousness which are simply the moment that follows the cessation of the previous moment. So therefore, they say, it doesn't come, it doesn't go, it doesn't divide. The cessation doesn't go anywhere, it just ceases. Because it ceases, it's the condition for this present moment to be there. But it won't stay because it ceases. So therefore, says the Huayan, what we are experiencing is merely Dharma Dhatu. It's merely, they say, clear light. I thought about clear light. What does it mean to say clear light? In a sense, this picture is not real in that sense. This picture I'm showing you up there, there is a swarm of light. Clear light is where there's light but there's no source. There's no spots in it. It's just the Dharma Dhatu is clear light. It's just light. But there's no focus of, oh, it's coming from that side or it's coming up or going down or it's being projected. It's just the Dharma Dhatu is merely this clear light. So that's why in this thing, past limit is not apprehended, the present can't be apprehended, and the limit of the future can't be apprehended. Every time I think, all right, I'm going to think this is the present. No, it's the past already. Every time I cannot find that limit. I just can't find it. Because the moment I have said something, it's already changed. So we have to live with that like an actor. I had a therapist friend, and he was talking about the fact that some people have hallucinations. It's a physical thing in their brain, they just have hallucinations. And he had a patient, could not get over it. The patient had a lot of insight, they tried and tried, so finally he said, look, just fake it. Yeah, they have these hallucinations. Just don't tell anybody about them. Just try to live your life. Because he believed that what was happening was a physical malfunction in the brain somehow that was producing this constant thing. So he said, how about just try to live with it? You don't have to say to everybody, hey, I heard a voice just now, then they're going to put you back in the hospital, so just make it. So we can't apprehend past, present, and future. But in a sense, we fake it. We just fake it. Maybe fake is not the right word, but we are, if we're living in the Dharma Dhatu and we could say, I understand that I'm living in this, and yet I understand that I'm also living in my body, and therefore I'm like an actor on the stage, and I have a greater consciousness than what I'm projecting. I'm seeing myself on the stage as the actor, and yet I'm going to project a certain element to the audience, and they're going to believe that I am really a very nice person when I'm not, in their thinking. Queen Elizabeth's mother once made a very probably insightful thing. She said, everybody thinks I'm really nice, and the truth is, I'm not. She says, I know, I'm not a very nice person, but everybody thinks I am, so therefore I smile and wave, and they think I'm nice. But in her other thinking, she obviously was thinking, I'm not who they think I am. They're projecting onto me something which I'm not, but I give it to them. I fake it. I just fake it. I'm sure probably any person who's in public life, like a politician or a royalty, they realize a lot of the time they just have to fake it. You're not allowed to show that other side, even though the person themselves. Now, if they lose track of that and they become lost in the fact of being king and queen, then they're in real danger. We have to have awareness, I think. An actor has to know that they're not the character they play. If they lose track of that, then they're in danger. Because they think like what they've faked has now suddenly become for them reality, and that's really dangerous because then they don't have any control over it. And people, it will get constantly under attack because there's no way that they have to sustain it. I was listening to somebody talking about the actress Joan Crawford. And after she was an older woman, somebody called her up and said, hey, let's go to dinner tonight. And she said, no, I don't think so. She said, it's so hard to put on Joan Crawford that it takes me too long. I can't put it on tonight. I can't go out the way I am. I can't go out into the world as anything other than Jane Crawford. So she was aware that she was playing this double role. So one of the metaphors that they used was an echo. So if you have an echo, says the text, do you think you're able to hold on to that echo? Can you safeguard it? Can you keep it? I hear an echo, and it says, can you hold on to it? What is the memory of sound? For example, I hear somebody laughing outside. Can I just take that sound and preserve it? How long can I preserve it? How long can I safeguard it? I don't want to ever lose that sound. Or I look at something and I see red or blue. How long can I hold that color and maintain that memory? So that's why the Ashta says the reality limit, the nature of everything can never be apprehended. You just can't apprehend it. It's like trying to hold on to an echo. It's a fleeting, momentary event, and even if I try to maintain that fleeting, momentary event, all I'm holding on to is my construction of what I thought it was. It's not the thing itself. So if I hear somebody laugh and then I say, I'm going to remember this. Well, what I remember is not that laugh. What I remember is the laugh that I have fought or dealt with in my own thinking. So then, we're coming to what we want to talk about. The body enlightened. Can the body be enlightened? Is the body, we say the mind can become enlightened? Can the body become enlightened? How does that happen in the Buddhist text? In the Huayin is, of course, the 52nd stage of development, which they call enlightenment. You have to go through 52 stages. That's why Sudana, the young man who goes out to find teachers, has to have 52 teachers. He has to have 52 steps that he goes through. Each teacher teaches him something else. So it's very hard to get to enlightenment because enlightenment isn't just a single insight. It's not even two, it's 52. Which is probably saying it's a lot. It takes a lot to have that moment of enlightenment. So this is what I'm going to talk about next hour, but let's, before we take the break today, let's open up for some more conversation from you. Yes?
This is just a thought back to when we were talking about photons and everything. It's always interesting to me how our new science, I'm going to say new in quote, air quotes here, how our new science reveals old truths, in a sense. And I always think it's so amazing, like, how did they know? Like, when somebody was talking about, you know, how the body really reduces to nothing, certainly they had seen the body in various states of decay, but how did they really know that they could say something that could still be true that our scientists are now looking at and saying, wow, look at that. I just always found it really interesting.
Well, one thing that I think is that I really truly believe that through time, people have been extremely perceptive about their observations. They observe the same reality to one degree that we observe today. It's not as if reality itself has changed that much. What they did not have is they did not have the enhancement tools that we have. So we know much more about the mechanism than they knew, but they knew what it was. That's why I go back often, as you've heard me say, to Darwin. Darwin's observation that there is evolution is correct from everything that science ever has been able to discover. But he didn't know the mechanism of it. But his observation was correct. So I can observe something and I can say, that car runs, it moves, I can drive it, but I may have, and I don't, it's a problem with myself as a car owner, I have the slightest real idea of how it works. I can't fix it. I'm not aware of the mechanism and the mechanics or the ways in which it does it, but my observation is quite correct. It moves. And it has a power which moves it. I can observe that. So once I observe it, then my interpretation of it may be as good as anybody else's interpretation of it. Even if I don't know the mechanism, I can make some very good ideas about the movement and about what motion is. So we go back to the Greeks and to the Buddhists and to other people. They talked about motion, and they talked about time, and they talked about the nature of the construct of the material world, and they really thought deeply about it and came up with some very important concepts that have helped put us at the place where science works. Science does its own thing, which is really marvelous, and it certainly tells us the mechanism of in ways which we've never had before. But I don't think it could have reached where it has reached without all of those observations and the thinking which went behind those up. So if a scientist feels they walk into a lab as a blank page and suddenly they can just start experimenting and find out fantastic and wonderful things about how things work without understanding what they bring into the lab, they bring in their education, they bring in their logic, they bring in all of the ideas which have been present in society for ages and thousands of years. That's all with them. And they sometimes don't give credit to it. So I make a distinction, though, between observation and the value of that observation and to the enhancement which allows us to see tiny objects or to see far out in space. We have learned to enhance ourselves. And what we have found out about the mechanism of the universe in recent last century has been fantastic. And I applaud it, and I love it, and I want to. So I don't mind taking that observation of the mechanism and going back and looking at the observations to say, this observation was correct. Science will give us an idea of why it was correct or how it works from another level. But I still believe that that observation was necessary for the scientist who did discover with enhancement that was not available to people before. So that's why when we first released the digital version of the Chinese Buddhist canon, where you could search for every single word and find every single example, we enhanced scholarship incredibly with that. Then I would see people putting in a footnote saying, well, I have discovered that there are 62 examples of this word. No mention of the enhancement that they had available to them, which was C-beta. And I looked it up, and C-beta created the report. There are 68 examples. If we don't tell people how we got to this wonderful insight, then it's plagiarism. The real thing was done by the computer. But the computer was not possible unless we had the input. And the input was not possible unless we had all of the years of preservation and constructing the texts and putting them together. The input of the text into the computer was just one step in this long, long step of how you deal with text. And it was totally dependent on what had come before it. So I feel the same about science. I want to say to the scientists, what you do is fantastic. Hooray, hooray, keep doing it. I love it. I want it. But don't be deceived that somehow, because you have the enhanced ability to do this, that you are totally freed from, should have some feeling for everything that's gone before you that made this possible for you to do this. And to understand that as a scientist, you probably should study what the Greeks and the Buddhists and the other people observed that led to part of what you have. You didn't get this all on your own. You're part of the world culture. And we all are. I don't want to put on stress on the Buddhists and say they should have known, they knew everything. They didn't know everything. In that sense, we know things they didn't know. We're enhanced. And that's as it should be. What's wrong with that?
So isn't Stephen Hawking, one of the greatest scientists, isn't he swaying more towards the Buddhist belief system? I mean, he's not coming out to say he's a Buddhist, but if you read a lot of his research, he himself is swaying towards the Buddhist side. His state of anger, one of the biggest emotions, is not something that you should not carry on.
Well, I feel that to really understand what's happening in science today, when we talk about the history of science, I feel the history of science is lacking in one sense. That the history of science feels that you start with somebody who invented the telescope. But when that person invented the telescope, what had preceded their building the telescope? They didn't start from nothing. People had been trying to deal with the heavenly bodies for centuries. And they had all kinds of observations about those. Some of them were not right because they didn't have the enhancement. But nevertheless, whoever deals and makes something, they're riding on the back of a long period of thought and observations and conclusions and practices that make it possible.
He even said, I just read very recently, that he, I don't want to say predicting, but he's stating that the earth will end in 1,000 years from now. I read that only the other day. I found that very... But back to the Buddhist mentality. Mm-hmm. Okay, so the new future Buddha's coming. Oh my God, what do we do? 1,000 years, I could be planning now. That's very recent. You know, that only 1,000 years.
Yeah, I've got my life planned out for 1,000 years.
Well, Buddhologists for a long time predict that, because right now we're in the declining era of this Buddha period, that Buddhism will disappear from Earth or from our humanity in 2,500 years. That's what a lot of them have been saying. It will disappear in 2,500 years. But yet, like I was saying, but I also was hearing that the appearance of Maitreya is not going to be happening for millions of years. So I don't know, it's going to be interesting.
I think it's like a long gap in terms of our next cycle. I think it's what you see, Stephen Hawking was saying is that the humanity is our actions that's causing the earth to disintegrate. Mm-hmm. So we're talking about global warming, we're talking about saving, even China itself is destroying all their